received to participate in this conference suggested that it would be useful to address the question, was El Greco a Cretan painter? For some months now, I have been entertaining the idea to step up to this podium, simply say, yes, he was. Thank you all for your time and attention, and enjoy the rest of the fabulous program. Tempting as this may be, however, it is nevertheless not an option, unfortunately. It cannot be denied that El Greco was indeed a Cretan painter. He was born and raised and received his first training as a painter in Candia, present-day Heraklion, the capital of Venetian Crete. But what did being Cretan entail at that particular time? This question cannot be answered on the basis of topography alone, especially because the works that have granted El Greco international fame were not made on Crete, and at first sight seem quite detached from anything associated with the Cretan, effectively post-Byzantine art of the time. The question must therefore be considered from different angles, taking into account the nature of 16th century Venetian Crete as a bicultural and bi-religious society, a unique environment that nurtured the formative stage of El Greco's exceptional artistic development. Crete came under Venetian rule in the aftermath of the first sack of Constantinople by the troops of the Fourth Crusade in 1204. Venice, a rising maritime and mercantile superpower, did not fail to recognize the importance of having a stronghold in such a strategic position in the Mediterranean. Having fought off Genoese competition, they succeeded in officially establishing control over the island in 1211. The Byzantines recaptured Constantinople in 1261, initiating the final stage in the long history of the Byzantine Empire under the Palaiologan dynasty. In the meantime, Crete remained in Venetian hands, although they had to deal with a number of uprisings against their regime. There still exists a romantic notion that these uprisings were all about the liberation of the local population and its unification with Byzantium. In actual fact, the rebellions appear to have been primarily about the local interests of the Cretan nobility, one of the main reasons that, as historians have argued, the Venetians managed to invariably suppress them all. Be that as it may, by the 14th century, there is evidence for increasing cross-cultural interaction, particularly in the form of mixed marriages and business transactions between the Cretans and the Venetian colonists. It has been established that the Venetians traded widely wine, cheese, wheat, honey, cypress wood, and later also olive oil obtained from Crete. Their trade brought considerable economic prosperity to rural Crete, as is attested by the extensive regional building activity of the time. The countryside of the island is peppered with literally hundreds of predominantly small Orthodox churches. Many of these are decorated with wall paintings, and fresco was undoubtedly the main artistic medium of the island during the first 2.5 centuries of Venetian domination. Some of the frescoes, notably in the vicinity of Candia, follow the latest Palaiologan style, as you can see here. But Western influences, a reflection of the cross-cultural interaction on Crete, can also be detected. For example, Venetian drinking glasses feature in the scene of Herod's feast and of the Last Supper in the Panagia Kerá at Kritsa, dated to the late 13th or early 14th century. Here they are. And just to show you, Kritsa is here. Such and similar Western influences can be found in a number of Cretan decoration. However, the style of fresco painting on Venetian Crete remained resolutely Byzantine. This is a very interesting case, as you can see what I call the Byzantine character in quotation mark. This is Saint Bartholomew, who is holding his flayed skin, which is actually depicted according to Western tradition, because according to Greek Orthodox Church, he was crucified. But clearly, he found his way in a Byzantine gathering according to Western tradition. And of course, this is a much more typical Byzantine example. The second and final fall of Constantinople in 1453, this time to the Ottoman Turks, was of course a major political landmark in the 15th century Mediterranean landscape. On Crete, it marked the beginning of an era commonly referred to as post-Byzantine, which introduced important shifts. Firstly, for the natives, the Venetians became unreservedly the goodies, the baddies being a role now played in the Mediterranean by the Ottomans, of course. Secondly, Venice became now the major point of cultural and artistic reference on Crete. Thirdly, the gradual movement of the population from the countryside to the major cities on the north coast, in combination with a saturation of this particular market due to the sheer numbers of existing churches, affected the production of wall paintings, which experienced a steep and rapid decline. At the same time, the late 15th century witnessed the rise of the new champion of Cretan artistic production, that of the icon. New iconographic types started being introduced into post-Byzantine art, but they displayed a significant duality. Sometimes were strictly destined for the austere context of a Greek Orthodox church. For example, St. John the Baptist with wings is a type originally destined for an Orthodox templon, the screen, basically. Here it is. I mean, I'm just showing that it's obviously 20th century, but to the day it still continues to have this function. And this type of St. John the Baptist with wings never became part of Western iconography. At the same time, hybrid types, such as the Madre della Consolazione, emerged, which combined both Byzantine and Western elements, and thus appealed to the mixed clientele of the island, as well as to an audience beyond Crete's borders. I do not wish to give you the wrong idea and present post-Byzantine Crete as an earthly paradise, where its inhabitants had discovered the key for a peaceful coexistence. One of the things that remained unchanged on Venetian Crete, even after 1453, for example, was that the colonists and the natives regarded each other as heretics. In all likelihood, there was no doubt in the minds of the Greek Orthodox native population that the Roman Catholic rulers were destined to burn in hell in the company of other arch-heretics who betrayed Christ and his church, such as Arius. And here you have them all. Basically, the religious divide remained an unbridgeable gap, and here you have it. Orthodox clergy, Western clergy, all together in hell. Nevertheless, Crete at the time of El Greco was born, raised and trained there, around the mid-16th century, was one harmonious paradox. On the one hand, it had been elevated to one of the most important centers for the preservation of Greek identity, linguistically, religiously, in the form of Orthodoxy, and artistically, in the form of post-Byzantine iconography. On the other, it was a flourishing Venetian colony, enjoying an important status in Venice's maritime empire, and benefiting from cultural contacts and trade with the West. Modern historians have labeled the island, with very good reasons, as the Serenissima's most precious possession in the Mediterranean. Hence, while it is not my aim to act as a film critic here today, I cannot help but remarking on one bit of misleading information included in the film El Greco, The Painter of God, released in 2007. There, El Greco, as a young trainee in Titian's workshop, is introduced as a painter who comes from an island of which nobody knows where it is. It is questionable that 16th century Venetians would not have been aware of Crete's existence or geographical position. Actually, impossible, I think. But the main consequence of the increasing demand for both pure Byzantine and hybrid icons was that the artists living, training, and working on Crete had to adhere to a visual bilingualism. In other words, it was imperative for their careers that they knew how to paint both alla maniera greca, in the Greek manner, and alla latina, in the Western manner. The dexterity the Cretan artists developed caused the art from the island to enjoy a certain reputation beyond its boundaries during this time, which in turn brought the Cretan artists' fame. Documents discovered in the Venetian archives suggest that around 1500 Cretan post-Byzantine icons reached a great popularity, being produced en masse and in a collaboration of a number of workshops in the capital Candia over a short period of time and destined for export to major European destinations. For example, an extensively published contract informs us of the commission of 700 icons of the Virgin that two dealers placed to three Cretan artists to be delivered within only 42 days. At the same time, Crete's leading position in the post-Byzantine Mediterranean era as the stronghold of Byzantine artistic production caused Cretan artists to be sought after in other Orthodox areas. Places such as Mount Athos and the Greek community in Venice, when in need of painters to guarantee the conservative aspect of Byzantine style, turned to the island in search of a solution. For instance, Theophanes Trelidzas, also surnamed Bathas, Professor Kostadoudaki mentioned him already, who overlapped with El Greco for some years since he died in 1559, was called to Meteora in mainland Greece, as well as to Mount Athos, to produce both frescoes and icons for these prestigious Greek Orthodox monastic establishments. In his signature, in the monastery of St. Nicholas Anapafsas at Meteora in 1527, his earliest surviving works outside his native island, Theophanes stated that he was a monk on Crete. Cretis and Crete. This specific declaration of origin does not appear again in any other of his existing signatures. Unlike his younger compatriot, El Greco, who identified himself as Cretan in foreign surroundings, Theophanes worked almost exclusively for Orthodox monastic institutions outside Crete. It is possible that Theophanes' statement is topographical in this case. In other words, his intention here may have been to distinguish himself as a monk from Crete amidst other monks from different locations. It should be noted here that the case of Theophanes provides us with evidence that despite the overwhelming domination of icon production in post-Byzantine Crete, how to work on monumental decoration continued to be part of the artist's training. In fact, it continued well into the 17th century. The frescoes in the monastery of Dimitsana in the Peloponnese are attributed to the 17th century Cretan painter Victor. Currently, we have no information that El Greco was either trained in this medium or had any interest in it. Nevertheless, and based on the existing evidence provided by the post-Byzantine artists, we should not be surprised if it were one day to emerge that El Greco had painted frescoes too. El Greco's education and training as a young apprentice in the 16th century cultural hub of Candia has been discussed extensively and thoroughly by Nikolaos Panagiotakis in his El Greco, The Cretan Years, which was translated in English in 2009. Various speculative suggestions have been made over the years that El Greco may have been acquainted with some prominent representatives of Cretan art, such as Theophanes Trelidzas, Bathas mentioned above, or even Michael Damaskinos. What we know for certain is that El Greco was in contact with the icon painter and miniaturist George Clonzas. Clonzas acted as one of the experts in the evaluation of El Greco's Passion of Christ, for which he had obtained the right from the Venetian authorities to sell by the system of lot of in 1566. Now, Professor Nano Hatzidakis has identified this painting as the one the contract discusses, but arguing either way here, it's beyond the scope of my paper, so I'm just going to leave it as is. It is generally accepted that with this auction, El Greco aimed at raising money for traveling to Venice. However, whether Clonzas was also Theotokopoulos' teacher remains a conjecture without further supporting evidence at this moment. El Greco's signature in the Dormition of the Virgin and St. Luke painting the Virgin has left no doubts that the artist, while on Crete, was trained in Byzantine panel painting. The icon of the Virgin Odigitria, meaning the one who shows the way, that St. Luke is depicted painting, is one of the finest examples of the most popular type of the Virgin and Child in Byzantine art. El Greco's decision to go to Venice was not uncommon for 16th century Cretans. In 1498, the Greeks in Venice were granted permission to establish a confraternity. In the post-Byzantine era, Venice embraced her self-fashioned role as a successor of Byzantine culture, and the establishment of the confraternity became an additional point of attraction for many Greeks living in Venetian-dominated territories. El Greco was neither the first nor the last who went to Venice in pursuit of career options. Published documents indicate that more than 125 artists were living and working in Kandy in the 16th century, a city with roughly 15,000 inhabitants at the time. With one artist for every 120 inhabitants, the profession must have been highly competitive. And while Venice must have been equally, if not more, competitive, it must nevertheless have offered a more wide-ranging, challenging, and ambitious alternative. It would be interesting to compare El Greco's career path to that of two other Cretan artists, more or less his contemporaries, who also went to Venice. The one is Ioannis Permeniatis, who once there remained in the city. The other is Michael Damaskinos, one of the most acclaimed icon painters of the second half of the 16th century, who opted to return back to his native island. And also it's Professor Konstantoudakis' baby, I have to say, Michael Damaskinos. Ioannis Permeniatis is the older of the three by more than a generation. Sources confirm the artist was already present in Venice in 1523. Permeniatis was certainly trained as a pure Byzantine icon painter, as surviving works confirm. His Virgin and Child enthroned with St. John the Baptist and Augustine, on the other hand, is an altarpiece that was probably made for the Scuola dei Botteri, the confraternity of the barrel makers in Venice, where it remained until 1840. St. Augustine's presence here, is possibly explained by his capacity as the patron saint of brewers. He must have been one of the confraternity's patron saints. Tradition has it that this altarpiece was transported from Candia to Venice, in other words, that it was not made in situ. There is no direct evidence to support this claim, but there are precedents for such a commission at a distance. For example, in 1492, the Venetian ruler of Nafplion in the Peloponnese, Giovanni Nanni, commissioned from one of the most acclaimed late 15th century post-Byzantine Cretan icon painters, Nikolaos Tzafouris, a rather large altarpiece, now lost, which involved the collaboration of another painter, Georgios Vlastos, and of a sculptor, Nikolaos Barbarigo, all living and working in Candia at the time. The other comparative case is provided by Michael Damaskinos, 1535 to about 1592 or 1593, a slightly older contemporary of El Greco's and an artist held in great esteem among Byzantine icon specialists. The Greek confraternity in Venice clearly was in agreement with this evaluation, since they invited Damaskinos to decorate the San Giorgio dei Greci, San George of the Greeks. In 1514, the Doge granted the Greeks the right to purchase a plot on which to construct a church. The construction started in 1536 and finished in 1577. The church, which still forms part of Venice's building fabric, was dedicated to St. George, patron saint of the Greek soldiers, who in this case were instrumental of achieving the permission due to their contribution to the war against the Turks. Damaskinos decorated the Church of the Greeks in Venice between 1574 and 1582. This was a prestigious commission for Damaskinos. At the same time, the prestige of the Greek community also relied on the fact that they managed to bring over to Venice an acclaimed painter as the principal decorator. The fame and status of the one reinforces the fame and status of the other in a mutual prestigious exchange. Damaskinos' work further confirms the bilingualism and the ability of Cretan painters to paint in both manners, Greek and Western. Once in Italy, he was commissioned to paint the Madonna del Rosario for a Catholic church in Puglia, the Chiesa di San Benedetto in Conservano, dated 1572. As far as we know, Ioannis Permeniatis remained in Venice, yet his work is studied primarily by Byzantinists interested in post-Byzantine era and its developments. Michael Damaskinos returned to Crete, where he remained until his death, having turned down a further invitation by the Greek confraternity to return to Venice. His quality cast him among the leading post-Byzantine Cretan icon painters and certainly one who made his mark on the artistic production of the second half of the 16th century. His dexterity in expressing the pure Byzantine manner, pure in inverted commas always, of course, as well as his receptiveness to Western influences, testify to the ability that came with receiving training in the post-Byzantine idiom and style on Crete at the time. The career paths of these two compatriots of El Greco highlight perfectly two of the main options that would have also been available to him. By staying in Venice, he would have ended up working in the long shadow cast by Titian and Tintoretto, not really a competition any young ambitious painter would have found appealing. It is not a coincidence that the two main points of gravitation in the study of El Greco's work remain his Cretan origins and his Spanish period. By returning to Crete, he would have ended up being just another Cretan post-Byzantine bilingual icon painter, probably one of the very best and most celebrated ones, but not a crucial figure in the history of Western European painting. Hence, he opted for a third path that brought him to a land and a city which he adopted and where he remained, never to see his native island again. So, what does his Cretan background and training have to do with the road that led from the Byzantine Dormition of the Virgin, produced at the beginning of his career, to his Visitation, created close to the end of his life? What, if any, credits are due to his cultural origins? It is doubtful, not to say impossible, that any scholar in the right frame of mind, in the absence of evidence, such as signature, documents, would have suspected a link between these two works, and pursued an attribution to the same hand based on a good old-fashioned stylistic comparison. The one presents us with an austere religious subject, recognizable as such regardless of its context, with a few innovative details, such as this, the little fountain he puts there, the candlestick. As was the norm within Byzantine visual culture, where change happened slowly and followed subtle steps. The same is not true for the second work, however. Once taken out of its context, one would be hard-pressed to recognize a religious narrative here. The subject has been reduced to two figures, standing opposite one another with no indication of their saintly status. Are they real? Are they apparitions in one's dream? Are they neighbors knocking on each other's door early in the morning to borrow some milk? Looking at his Visitation, it becomes clear why El Greco's work attracted the admiration of artists of the modern era. There can be no doubt that El Greco still identified with and felt attached to his Cretan origins, even after he had immigrated. In the decade between 1570s and 1580s, in a number of the signatures he placed on his work, he stated his Cretan origins, Cris. In other words, the time frame of the appearance of the declaration of his Cretan identity starts shortly after his departure from Crete and ends shortly after his settling down in Spain. As long as El Greco remained on Crete, the declaration of his origins among his natives and peers was redundant. As soon as he left the island and landed in a place which was familiar with Cretan post-Byzantine artistic production, he may have placed his origins to be identified as a bilingual artist. The popularity of post-Byzantine icons may have provided an additional incentive for this declaration, as it did for a number of his compatriot Cretan painters who stated their place of origin on their signed works. The difference with El Greco is that while his colleagues signed on the basis of their intended clientele either in Greek or in Latin, El Greco invariably used Greek script for all his signatures. As far as we know, El Greco never made the distinction between the two languages, and this could be interpreted as the first attempt to step outside his native professional crowd, to approach his work differently in order to be different. It is possible that once in Spain, El Greco realized that his Cretan origins probably did not carry as much weight as they did in Italy, where there was a lot of familiarity with Greek culture and probably also specifically with the artistic output of post-Byzantine Crete. While the ability to read his Greek signatures probably remained the privilege of a limited number, at the same time, the foreign language would have made him stand out among colleagues. I am not a supporter of projecting present-day logic and facts back onto the past in order to interpret and to understand societies in different circumstances. However, this is a case where we could perhaps entertain the possibility that in the long run, the signature in Greek characters, not necessarily the understanding of it, was actually the aim of El Greco, what we should have called today his trademark, his logo. To literally illustrate my point, please raise your hand if you do not recognize what this is. There can also be no doubt that the fame and status El Greco holds presently in the international stage of art history is tied to his creation in Spain. It is neither the small but choice surviving corpus from his Cretan phase, nor his output of his Italian sojourn, although it has to be said that this middle phase is the least explored. There's no way one can prove it, but the assumption could be made that had he stayed on Crete or remained in Venice, we would not have been gathered here today in celebration of his achievement based on the subsequent development of a stylistic expression which has been admired, among others, by the film director Sergei Mikhailovich Eisenstein and the modern era artists Pablo Picasso and Jackson Pollock. Yet, it were his Cretan origins, initially, in combination with the Greek alphabet that he used to identify himself and his works. As I'm sure you all know well, El Greco's characteristic look and stylistic expression, which he developed and perfected in Spain, has been the subject of long discussions. Many suggestions have been put forward in order to explain it, including a handicap, a visual defect, that of astigmatism. As far as I'm aware, this latter suggestion is not considered seriously any longer, although in all fairness, we would not be able to either prove or disprove it. What we can do, however, is to examine all circumstances to evaluate whether this look was a personal and targeted choice rather than a bodily malfunction. In 2008, Professor Hadzinikolaou offered the following insightful translation of El Greco's own commentary in Castilian in the margin of Vasari's Lives. If, that is Vasari, really knew the nature of the Greek style of which he speaks, he would deal with it differently in what he says. He compares it with Giotto, but what Giotto did is simple in comparison because the Greek style is full of ingenious difficulties. This is a very important statement by an artist who, unlike Vasari, had in-depth knowledge of both Byzantine and Renaissance art. Of an artist who, in the same copy of Vasari, in the Life of Tintoretto, stated that the latter's crucifixion in the Scuola Grande di Sarocco, completed 1565, was the best painting in the world today. In other words, El Greco did not display a cultural devotion, but rather a specialist respect towards his original training. On the basis of this evidence, would it then be possible to consider his Greek Cretan signatures as a manifestation of this respect and an indication of one of the inspirational sources of his work, Cretan Paleologan and post-Byzantine art? As mentioned above, Constantinople remained the main point of artistic reference for Cretan artists until its fall to the Ottomans in 1453. The cultural exchange between the capital and Crete is well attested. Documentary evidence testified to the fact that Constantinopolitan painters came to Crete and worked on church commissions in the area around the capital Candia. At the same time, Cretan painters visited Constantinople. Based on his translated and well-published will dated 1436, we are aware that the 15th century Cretan painter Angelos Akontandos planned a trip there. The peril of the journey was actually the reason he made his will. Angelos was a painter who, while still rooted in the Byzantine traditions, also began to introduce innovations that would become defining characteristics of post-Byzantine painting during the next generation. For example, what I showed you earlier, St. John the Baptist with wings, is considered to be his introduction into post-Byzantine art. There can be little doubt that Angelos, when he reached Constantinople sometime after 1436, visited the stunning monuments of the city, exemplifying the Paleologan style, Byzantine art's swan song in artistic expression. The epitome of the Paleologan style, which retrospectively has been branded as one of the Renaissance phases of Byzantine culture, can be seen in the funerary side chapel, Paraeklesion, of the Hora Monastery, decorated with mosaics and frescoes and sponsored by Theodore Metochitis, here he is with his fabulous hat, who was the Grand Logothetis, a sort of prime minister at the time, and which was completed by Christmas 1321. Now, I have placed these two works on the screen next to each other for you to look at while I'm quoting from Lynn Lordley's description of Palaeologan style. A distinctive style which display mannered figures of non-naturalistic proportions. Typically, there is a long distance between waist and knee. And a disproportionately short distance between knee and foot. Figures are also narrow at shoulders and feet, billowing out at waist and hip. While there is a variety and mobility in the postures and expressions of figures, it responds to a pictorial dynamic rather than to naturalism. For the record, I'm not suggesting here that El Greco visited Constantinople and so first had the spectacular horror decoration. I wish I could, but I can't. Unlike in the case of Angelos, there is no evidence that El Greco ever visited Constantinople. Furthermore, there would not have been any reason for a Greek-speaking artist to visit the city, which as the capital of the Ottoman Empire was no longer the driving force for the latest developments in Byzantine art. Moreover, and actually more importantly, the Hora in particular had been converted to a mosque in the 16th century, so even if El Greco had been there, he would not have seen it. Therefore, one can assume almost with certainty that El Greco would have not been familiar with what is now deemed the best representative Palaeologan style has to offer. But he could have seen high-quality Palaeologan art on his native island. For example, parenthetically, you can see how bad the state of our Cretan frescoes is, but never mind, that's a different issue. Fine examples of Palaeologan art can be seen in the Church of Christ at Potamies, dated after 1375, and in the Church of St. Constantine and Helena at Avdou, dated by inscription 1445. Both churches are not far from Heraklion. Potamies is circa 37 kilometers away, Avdou 39, so relatively close. Once more, there's no documentary evidence that El Greco ever visited rural locations on the island to view church decoration, but the suggestion that he might have done is not unreasonable. Furthermore, we should not forget that while today, due to urban redevelopment, the original city fabric of Venetian Candia is all but lost, during El Greco's time, there were numerous Orthodox churches in and around the capital, quite a few of which are likely to have had Palaeologan-style decorations. It is likely that had we not known that El Greco was originally trained as an icon painter, the comparisons between Byzantine art and his late works would have never been pursued, at least not seriously. But even if that had been the case, it would not have meant that the close relation between the Byzantine tradition and El Greco's art is not there, carefully transformed and visually served in an innovative package that captures the attention and imagination. However, our factual knowledge makes it impossible to disregard the influence Byzantine iconography exercised on some of his renowned creations. For example, I'm not the first to suggest that obviously the iconography of the betrayal, potential influence on his disrobing Christ. I need to show you this. Perhaps, I mean, I know this is considered to be from Tintoretto's crucifixion, but I don't know if you look at the episode of St. Peter cutting off Malchus's ear, maybe. And of course, again, I'm sure you have heard that before, Dormition of the Virgin on his burial of Count Orgath. They all have been noted, obviously, with good reason. Being trained in Byzantine art taught him how to manipulate space in order to allow for the surroundings of figures to remain unidentified. The essence of the Byzantine icon is to function as a window to a world that is not real, to the heavenly world above where the saintly figures reside. It is a choice for Byzantine art not to engage with special surroundings, perspective for shortening the material world. The aim is to reproduce a world where the laws of nature, such as gravity, cast shadows, and other such phenomena, do not have a place, an immaterial world. Byzantine artists were trained to copy the prototypes, the original images, faithfully, not to reproduce nature directly. This practice was regarded as the safety net against idolatry. The close reproduction of the prototype guaranteed that the image participated in the divine nature of the saintly figure and/or event, and hence worship was directed to the actual figure and or event, not to the material on which they were depicted. Take, for example, one of the most popular type of Byzantine, post-Byzantine icon, that of the Virgin and Child. And I put there, obviously, Mother della Consolazione because it's closer to El Greco's time. The gold background does not distract the viewer from the subject matter. On the contrary, the surroundings collapse, and it is irrelevant where the Virgin and Child are situated. They could be, and in fact are, everywhere. The support, or rather, the lack of support, that the Virgin's arm offers to Christ's child underlies his immateriality. For anybody who has held that child over 1 kilo of weight, you can see this is impossible. You're just going to drop the baby. You cannot hold it like that. Christ is more spirit than flesh, and this is one of the conventions Byzantine art invented to communicate this to the faithful. From a Western perspective, such as the one taken by Vasari in the 16th century, it is tempting to interpret this as inept technique, as inability to reproduce a naturalistic image of the Virgin holding Christ. However, the literally thousands surviving examples that reproduce exactly the same position should raise the question. If this was not intentional, was there not even one good Byzantine painter able to depict this correctly? I mean, honestly. The characteristic, the deliberate aloofness of the Byzantine Virgin, who does not engage with the viewer, but at the same time draws them into her world. It could be argued that El Greco was able to apply this selectively to his portraiture. For example, in his depiction of Adonio de Covarrubias, the artist perhaps applied to his sitter something of this unearthly quality attested in the Byzantine icons of the Virgin, who, I need to remind you, the Byzantine icon of the Virgin is actually considered a portrait among the Greek Orthodox faithful. This comparison may acquire an additional perspective if we take into consideration that de Covarrubias was one of the key intellectual figures of Toledo, and this aloofness may be used to indicate his engagement with the intellectual world beyond that of the material. I have already touched upon the potential influence of Paleologan style, that Paleologan style may have played in the formation of his bodies. Disproportionate and elongated Paleologan art offers the core of a possible inspiration to transform the body in this way. It could be argued that El Greco further explored the lack of interest Byzantine art displays towards the representation of correct anatomy. The formation of the folds in his draperies is another aspect of El Greco's art that has attracted attention. He tends to wrap his figure in what resembles thin pieces of folded metal. This may echo the sharp formation of the folds as seen in post-Byzantine icons. It is possible to detect El Greco's original fold formation already in the angel seen in his Luke painting the Virgin. The sharp, stiff definition of drapery, closely related to the style of late and post-Byzantine art, which would be subjected to extreme manipulation in later works, can be seen emerging here. In my opinion, there can be no doubt that El Greco is a Cretan painter, even in a sense that goes beyond geographical, linguistic, and ethnic origins. Once he found himself outside his native island, but within an environment where it meant something to come from Crete, he declared so as attested by his signature for roughly a decade. Once he moved further away, and his ethnic origins perhaps carried less weight, he may still have used aspects of his original training to develop a unique characteristic language. Having been trained in Cretan stylistic bilingualism, he was in the position to transform this pictorial language further. His marginal comment on Vasari's lives testifies that El Greco had deep respect for Byzantine art and, unlike Vasari, did not see it as the ashes from which Renaissance art had to be raised. He saw the potential for change and transformation it had and used his training to his advantage to create a new visual language to meet the artistic and spiritual needs of an audience both geographically and culturally far removed from his native island. El Greco career's choices took him out of Crete, but never really took Crete out of him. Thank you.